Hey everyone, how are you? My name is Bhaskar Sankar. I'm the editor and publisher of Jacobin magazine, and I'm the often the host of these Jacobin talks, which we've been doing a few times a week on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays at 6 p.m. or thereabout. We've been having a left-wing thinker, and we've been going through a particular topic, often a controversial one, always an interesting one, for around a half an hour. And then we've been taking questions from our audience. So today is September 16th, 2020. It's a significant day for Jacobin because Jacobin was founded 10 years ago today. It was meant to launch on September 15th, 2010. I think we were delayed for some reason, so it launched the next day as an online publication. Obviously, since then, it's ballooned into a publication that has, you know, well over a dozen staff, that has franchises in different countries, and that now reaches over 60,000 people in print and a couple million people a month on the website. And all that is a surprising thing, considering how absolutely frazzled the left was 10 years ago and how weak the socialist movement was. I think my idea going into founding Jacobin was just to make a couple interventions of note and to try to keep alive the flame of some sort of democratic socialism for future generations that might have better political prospects. But my vision of things was obviously very pessimistic. We're seeing now the emergence of a real movement to the left of liberalism. For all our defeats, for all our failures, the left is in much better shape than it was 10 years ago or 5 years ago. Obviously, the lion's share of that credit has to go to the protagonists of new social movements, to everyone involved with Occupy and the Wisconsin uprising and Black Lives Matter and all the other movements of the last decade. But of course, also to the Sanders and Corbyn projects too. And I think Bernie Sanders in particular has done a lot more than Jacobin to keep alive the vision of some sort of socialism, even if we might quibble over what it means and what its end goal is. But I do think we played a really important role bringing in keeping alive class analysis on the left, bringing in a lot of thinkers that people wouldn't have otherwise heard before, and pushing for a left that aims to be both more rigorous, more serious, but also more accessible, and showing that those two things aren't incompatible. But in fact, if we are thinking seriously, it becomes easier for us to not be a subculture, to not just be an in-group with our own obscure language and with our own various different symbolism and whatever else. We are aiming, of course, not to be alternative media. We're aiming to be the future mainstream media. And obviously, these are still very humble beginnings, both for the YouTube channel, which we launched with the help of Kale Brooks, our producer, and of course, the late, great Michael Brooks, no relation, earlier this year. But we're continuing on with the project. So if you do want to support Jacobin, stay tuned. We're going to be doing a fundraising drive later in the month. In the meantime, please press like. Press subscribe, help keep us going for the next year, for the next 10 years. And without further ado, I should plug that we are doing another show on Friday. We have Stephanie Luce, I think, on Friday, talking about the politics of full employment. We have another edition of Weekends on Saturday with Anna and Nando, and their guest is Amber Frost, who'll be talking about her new review essay in Catalyst, the journal edited by NYU and Jacobin's Vivek Chibber. And today we are joined by a good friend of mine, Christian Parenti, who, like a lot of my friends, I have not seen in quite some time, I guess since probably the very beginning of 2019 or something like that, in part because of the pandemic. But Christian both played a role in the, probably more than he knows, in the founding of Jacobin, because his friends, along with his friends Liza Featherstone and Doug Henwood, were pretty helpful early on, telling people about the launch of Jacobin when we were very small. And I think we ran an excerpt for Tropic of Chaos, and maybe our second issue or third issue, one of the very early issues of Jacobin, which is his unfortunately very prophetic book on climate change and the new geography of violence, which was came out maybe 8 years ago, something like that, right?
Yeah, 9 years ago.
Yeah. And in addition to that, he's the author of Lockdown America, Police and Prisons in the Age of Crisis, which came out from Verso. I have no idea when, but it's
originally 1999, yeah. And then reissued an updated version with an appendix, right, in 2008.
So after a long hiatus, Christian returned to Verso and released his new book, Radical Hamilton: Economic Lessons from a Misunderstood Founder. And as I mentioned before, when Christian was on to debate with Lee nuclear power, the Radical Hamilton thesis or work that Christian was doing was first kind of debuted in Jacobin in the form of a long essay that he wrote a few years ago in Jacobin. So it's an idea very close to our heart. You know, back then, I think a lot of people in the Jacobin milieu felt very comfortable with a contrarian take that said that, you know, Hamilton's actually far more interesting than leftists gave him credit for. You know, he had its faults. He was certainly no friend of democracy. But if people saw some good qualities in the thought of, you know, Jefferson, who was a slave owner, you might as well find some glimmers of interesting things in Hamilton, or at the very least, had... lots of modern ideas about the trajectory of capitalism that we can learn from in many different respects. I think the Hamilton musical kind of threw some people off because now it became a liberal talking point between that and Chernow to defend Hamilton. But Christian never wavered. He maintained a kind of serious analysis of Hamilton that looked past his standing in the culture war, which has kind of gone back and forth. And today, yeah.
And I have not seen the musical.
Oh, you know, I saw the musical. It was fine. It was good. I don't really know how to judge musicals, but you know, it was okay. I think I saw it. I think I missed a Knicks Pistons game to see it. That's the only thing I remember. And I deeply regretted it. Yeah. Wow. For me, it's a big deal. It's kind of sickening. It's really sick. but I don't know. What can I do? Vivek Chibber from the Catalyst editor has never missed a Cleveland Browns game in about 10 years, which seems to me more sickening like that.
Wow.
It's disturbing. Socialists have a fetish for defeat. But in any case, we should let Christian probably move on and give his presentation. He'll talk for around 25, 30 minutes about Hamilton. Then after that, we'll take some questions from the audience. So please press like, press subscribe. If you have questions, please leave your questions as Christian's talking. Then we'll try to get to as many as possible. Christian, if you have to go over a little bit, that's fine. We'll try to get to as many questions as possible. Okay. But thanks again for joining us. And everyone, do check out his book from Verso as well.
Yeah. Thank you very much for doing this, for all your work. And thank you for having me on this series. It's an honor to be here. And like, if my mic is making bad noise, like scraping around or whatever, just let me know somehow. You know, my interest in Hamilton, as Bhaskar mentioned, I mean, I kind of backed into it by mistake. I was reading about him and noticed that there was mention of the report on the subject of manufacturers, which sounded like a very statist document, a planning document, a document that endorsed government planning and public ownership even, and the idea that government planning could drive an economic transformation. And so I was interested in learning more about that and quickly found that the literature on Hamilton generally got that the real nature of the report rather wrong frequently. People were all over on the map on what it said, and generally didn't discuss it in much detail. So then that plan was, oh, well, we should republish it, and I'll just, you know, refurbish that Jacobin article into an intro, and, well, the intro grew into a book. And so there you have it. So Hamilton, as you all know, probably he's an immigrant. He's born in the island of Nevis. He's orphaned young. He's very bright. He has to go to work at age 13, and he at a shipping company, and he starts writing essays for the local island press. And some of the notables recognize, oh, this guy's quite smart. So they take up a collection to send him to the mainland to attend what is now Columbia College, which was then King's College. He arrives shortly before the war begins in around 1775. Fighting begins in 1775 in Massachusetts. At this point, Hamilton is in New York, and there's no fighting down there, but there's lots of agitation and pamphleteering. And many of the students, he's been in university now for only a year, many of the students start forming militia companies and training, and he's one of them. The British are driven out of Boston and fall back to Nova Scotia, and then are going to invade New York, and Washington falls down to New York to occupy New York and defend against the British. And at that point, Hamilton is commissioned as an artillery officer in the Continental Army. He spends a year essentially defending Washington's retreat as the British drive Washington's army out of New York, out of Brooklyn, out of Manhattan, across the river, down through New Jersey and into Pennsylvania. And all this while, Hamilton's star is rising. He's a competent officer and well-liked by his men, et cetera. And he holds out, two different generals approach him and ask him to join their staff. And he holds out until he gets an appointment from Washington. And so then he joins Washington's family or his executive staff. And at that point, he goes from being a frontline officer to being a kind of military bureaucrat whose every minute is consumed by really the political economy of the war and how this war is to be won logistically. And he immediately sees that it is a total mess. At this point, the 13 colonies have come together under the Articles of Confederation, which are the first constitution, as it were, of the United States. And it is really just a loose defense pact. The member states maintain all their sovereignty. And Congress, which is the only national body produced by the Articles of Confederation, along with the Continental Army, Congress doesn't even have the power to tax. It has to request that the states raise money for it. So Hamilton's writing up to this point is it's typical of a lot of other pamphleteers. He's interested in democracy. It's kind of Lockean liberalism. And a crisis occurs during the war in the fall of 1777 going into the winter 1778. The Continental Army has been defeated again and again. Washington has fallen back now headed towards Valley Forge. Congress is driven out of Philadelphia by a British invasion, and Washington is blocking Congress at Valley Forge, protecting them from the British who are in Philadelphia. And around this moment, there is finally a victory in Saratoga, New York. A British army has come down from Canada and is blocked by General Gates at Saratoga, New York, and defeated, and all of its weapons are captured, and many of its troops are made prisoner. And so this is a huge boon for the cause. This is the basis for European financiers to take interest in loaning money to this project. And Washington, partly because of, you know, power plays and his own egotism, wants some of those weapons and troops to reinforce him, but also partly out of a legitimate strategic concern with defending the government, defending Congress. If Congress is taken prisoner by the enemy, that's sort of, you know, the end of the project in many ways. So he, for legitimate and illegitimate reasons, he wants support from Gates, who's up there, and he sends Hamilton up to try and get General Gates to release some of the weapons that he has captured and some of the supplies. In the meantime, General Gates and another general in the North, Putnam, are beginning to go rogue. They're planning their own independent assaults on New York. They're no longer communicating with Washington through the chain of command, but communicating directly with their state governments and directly with Congress. And the whole project is beginning to disintegrate. Hamilton goes up there alone with just an aide and manages to bring these two older men to heel. And they do dispatch some support to Washington. And then after that, this is like essentially 3 days of meetings, Hamilton collapses into what strikes me as a nervous breakdown. It's described as a nervous fever. He's described as ranting and hallucinating. And for 2 months, he has to coalesce in the house of a Patriot supporter. Finally, in January 1778, he makes it down to Valley Forge. And after that breakdown, his writing changes. And what happens next is that he starts writing these long, detailed letters to powerful figures in the Patriot movement. He writes to James Duane. He writes to his own future father-in-law, Robert Morris, major financier and funder of the revolution. And he lays out in these letters essentially the plan for the Constitution and the central bank and the idea of transitioning off away from a dependency on agrarian activities and agrarian exports towards a manufacturing-based economy. And these letters after this break are the first real iteration of what becomes the U.S. Constitution. It's the first time we see that in kind of embryonic form. So the war ends, and the peace treaty, the Treaty of Paris, is signed in 1783. Fighting in the Northeast ends more around 1780, 81. It shifts to the South. And the war has had contradictory effects in the colonies. It has, on the one hand, been a fetter to production. It has involved the burning of towns, the destruction of means of production, etc., the disruption of trade links. But on the other hand, it has been a massive stimulus to the economy of the 13 colonies. The amount of hard currency entering the country soars, and the amount of demand soars. You have these, by the end, three ravenous armies, the Americans, the British, and the French, and they need everything that you can imagine, not just weaponry and ammunition, but also clothing, paper, enormous amounts of salt for their horses, enormous amounts of fodder for their horses, enormous amounts of wood for heating. There's no salt industry in the colonies to speak of prior to the war, because salt was allowed under British mercantilist rules to come into the colonies as ballast in European, particularly generally British ships. Though there were even some exceptions to the kind of strict mercantilist controls that Britain had on trade with the colonies, and Mediterranean and French sourced salt were actually allowed in. With the war, all of that ends and a salt industry develops in the colonies. Similarly, the number of gunsmiths more than doubles. Similarly, with manufacturing of paper, of iron and steel and textiles, and on and on and on. The war has created this incredible kind of hothouse boom for the economy. With the end of the war, all of that stops. The ravenous foreign armies with their hard currency leave. The Continental Army constricts and is no longer in operations, and then diminished in size considerably. And so the economy goes into what we now realize was a depression as bad as the Great Depression. And it has taken generations for economic historians to patch together the kinds of data that you would need to get that sort of macroeconomic picture. But it's clear now that consumption collapses, investment collapses. And during the war, prices, inflation had been spiraling upwards. Now, after the war, there's a deflationary spiral, and that's very bad for investment, because if the purchasing power of money is increasing rather than being threatened by inflation, why risk your money investing if you know it will be worth more next year if you just hold on to it? So the situation is quite dire in the 1780s, and this leads to what is known as the critical period. Along with this economic depression, tied up with it are a number of political and military crises that develop. There is also, by 1783, two massive volcanic eruptions, one in Japan and one in Iceland. And the one in Iceland goes on for about a year. This leads to a cooling effect in the Northeast with very cold and wet winters and very cold and wet summers in which crops are lost. And when not lost in spring floods are harder to grow and not doing so well. So there, amidst this economic crisis, the states which maintain their sovereignty are beginning a series of trade wars against each other. There's growing violence along the frontier with Native American societies. There is a war with Maroons developing in Georgia and South Carolina. There are even small wars between rival groups of white settlers, one in what's now eastern Tennessee, the other in the Wyoming Valley of Pennsylvania. These are shooting wars in which, you know, poor and middle-class settlers backed by rival groups of speculators are shooting it out over conflicting land claims. New York is imposing tariffs on Connecticut and New Jersey. Maryland and Virginia are in a trade war over navigation and trade on the Chesapeake. So the whole thing is coming apart at the seams, and none of these political dynamics help in any way with that economic problem of an economic slump. This culminates with Shays' rebellion in Western Massachusetts. So the additional, sort of the third element, if you've got this kind of economic crash, you've got, I suppose it's more than four elements, economic crash, you've got bad climate events due to these volcanoes, and then all this violence and trade wars. The fourth thing is that all the states are trying to pay off their debts. They have all, to greater and lesser degrees, some states have really shouldered much more the burden than others, taken on enormous debts during the war, and they're now trying to pay off these debts. Congress as well has debts, and it is trying to pay off these debts. And what that means, by the late 1780s, Shays' Rebellion happens in 1786, is that state after state is seeing farmers extracted for every last resource they have. In Western Massachusetts, this means that there is a foreclosure epidemic. And in the late summer of 1786, in the face of this, you know, bad harvest and all this stuff, the farmers rebel. There's also similar rebellions in New Hampshire and Connecticut, but those don't turn into armed conflicts. The farmers rebel. They mob and shut down the courts and send the lawyers and the judges away. The elites on the coast of Massachusetts who have bought up most of this debt call out the militia. The militia again and again either switches sides or simply refuses to fight and melts away. And the elites have to fund a private military. And in the winter of 1776 going into 1777, there is full-blown class conflict, armed class conflict in Massachusetts with two major battles and lots of murders and intimidation and barn burning and that kind of stuff. And the rebellion is defeated. The Shaysites are defeated, but it has a galvanizing effect on the national political class, among them Hamilton. And they realize that the Articles of Confederation are not sufficient for the survival of this new Republican experiment. And it's worth pausing for a second to note that the American Revolution, say what you will about the United States, and we can all say all sorts of critical things about it, but this is the revolution that really inaugurates the great age of Republican government, right? The English Revolution, which precedes the American Revolution by 100 years, takes significant steps in that direction, but it doesn't end monarchy. It creates a constitutional monarchy. This is the first revolution that does away with monarchy altogether and creates a new basis for government. And in that regard, it's a model, you know, it influences the French Revolution and the Haitian Revolution and many other great revolutions thereafter. So this whole project is falling apart, and it's clear there has to be refounding. And thus, as Shays' Rebellion is being mopped up in late May of 1787, the delegates begin to gather in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia, for the Constitutional Convention. And the Constitution is typically looked at from the left and the right in terms of how government works. This is essentially the main question, right? Checks and balances, the three branches of government. But what I try to do in this book is also look at what this new government allowed itself to do. What powers did it give itself? And what were the implicit projects in that? And I don't track down all of the projects. You can see very clearly that a kind of imperial global presence is very much written into the Constitution. But there is, for better and for worse, also written into it, I argue, a developmentalist project. The outlines of a Dyergist developmentalist state, a government that gives itself the power and the means to intervene in the economy and totally transform it according to some desired end. And the Constitution enables this project of essentially planning and economic transformation. And this is all laid out in Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution, which surprisingly is not discussed that much in the literature on the Constitution. It's sort of the boring part where Congress enumerates what it is allowed to do, what the Congress is supposed to be the supreme, the legislative branch is supposed to be the supreme branch of this government. And so Article 1, Section 8 enumerates what it can do. And what is laid out there is actually the kind of economic toolbox. The Congress allows itself to coin money, to regulate commerce between states, to regulate commerce between states and foreign countries. It gives itself exclusive control of all these federal lands that it's about to gather up. It gets down to the level of setting national standards for weights and measures. It allows itself to handle bankruptcies, and on and on and on. All of these things that we take for granted are laid out in Article 1, Section 8. And the discussions and struggles around Article 1, Section 8 are revealing. For example, the Federalist, the kind of developmentalist elements in the Federalist Party, they didn't have parties in a formal sense in at this time. So Hamilton and Franklin, for example, are eager to use the federal government to fund internal improvements, that is to say, infrastructure, the clearing of rivers, the creation of canals and of roads. That is explicitly defeated particularly by Southern interests that are afraid of the cost and afraid of the implications that if this new central government is allowed too much power, who knows where it will end. Because, of course, it is worth mentioning that at this point, several states have either outlawed slavery completely or are on their way. So Vermont has outlawed slavery. Massachusetts, through court cases, has outlawed slavery. Pennsylvania has outlawed slavery. Connecticut is on the way, and New York are on the way to outlawing slavery. So even at the founding of the Constitution, there are real and quite legitimate fears from the Southern slaveholding elite that this new emerging central state, what modern social scientists would call a fiscal military state, that this central state, if allowed to build canals and roads, et cetera, could very well come and impose its will on the slaveocracy and end slavery. And in fact, that is what happens. And John Rutledge of South Carolina at the convention actually brings this up. This is a quote worth reading. And any Civil War buffs out there will be interested in sort of putting this in context of how old the threat of secession was. So this is like at the convention. John Rutledge of South Carolina, speaking at the convention, he was speaking in defense of the slave trade. There's a discussion about what are they gonna do about the slave trade? And what the Constitution does is it says that the slave trade will not be attacked by Congress until 1808. So it protects the slave trade, but it also implicitly opens the door for an end to the slave trade. And Rutledge of South Carolina says, "Religion and humanity have nothing to do with this question. Interest alone is the governing principle with nations. The true question at the present is whether the Southern states shall or shall not be parties to the Union. If the Northern states consult their interests, they will not oppose the increase of slaves, which will increase the commodities of which they will become carriers." So even at the convention, there's this like explicit threat of secession. So it's that fear from Southern elites primarily, but not exclusively, that blunts to some extent the desire of Hamilton and others like him to create a state that has more explicit powers to transform the economy. So Benjamin Franklin, for example, wanted to explicitly have language about building canals. And the closest they got was that in the postal clause, it says that the federal government has the right to set up post offices and build post roads. Well, that language will, by the 1830s and 40s, enable all sorts of federally funded transformations. Hundreds and hundreds of miles, of probably thousands of miles of river cleared at federal expense. Tens of thousands of miles worth of road built by the federal government. And also some canals assisted with federal support, all under this postal clause. So long story short, I read the Constitution, or we kind of read political economy back into the Constitution. Constitution is ratified. It has to be, you know, there's considerable opposition to the Constitution because there are elite states' rights types who don't like what they see in it. And there are also popular forces that are afraid of this large government. And they want to make sure that there are protections for individual liberties built into this. And so the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, are promised as the price of ratification. And had it not been for this explicit tacking on of a set of protections, you know, free speech, freedom of assembly, protection against unlawful search and seizure, the document would not have been ratified. Once it's ratified, there's an election, Washington is elected, and Hamilton is appointed his Treasury Secretary. As Treasury Secretary, Hamilton begins his job with a series of reports to Congress in which he discusses public lands and the creation of a central bank, and ultimately the report on the subject of manufacturers, which is really the heart of the book here. And Congress, the story goes that Congress essentially goes along with the creation of a bank and a mint and the plan to assume all these Western state land claims and turn these claims by these states upon Western lands into federal lands. And in exchange, the federal government will assume the debts of the states and reinflate the economy. They go along with all this, but they balk at the subject at the question of manufacturers. And the report on subject of manufacturers is dismissed as having had no effect, and thus generally move on. But if you read the report on manufacturers, it becomes clear why we don't discuss it more. And the fact of the matter is it wasn't so immediately rejected. A lot of what was proposed in it does become federal law, and much of it also is picked up by states and pursued by states in their developmental efforts. The report opens with an attack on Adam Smith, an explicit attack on Adam Smith. I hesitated saying explicit because in the 18th century, authors had a weird habit of not quoting directly or not naming who they were quoting. They would quote, they would paraphrase, and they would even quote, but not name who they were quoting, and they would sometimes kind of misquote. So the report has, you will not find the words Adam Smith in the report, but you will find quotes of Adam Smith and also these weird quotes that are like 95% Adam Smith, but like the wording is off somehow. Perhaps that's because Tench Cox and Alexander Hamilton were in a rush as they did this. They were working from various, bootlegged copies of Wealth of Nations. Anyway, Hamilton opens by saying, look, the whole idea of free trade only works if you're already a winner. That only works if you're the UK, right? If you're already in charge of a huge empire, that's great. But for us, to put it in modern terms, it's like post-colonial revolutionary project that can barely hold itself together, free trade is not going to get the job done. And the only way that sovereignty can be protected, the only way that this political experiment will survive is if there is a state built that is strong enough to manage economic growth and to really plan for economic growth and to defend itself internationally. Now, I hesitated saying that too, because today in the United States, the military-industrial complex is a grotesquely bloated corporate welfare agency that wastes U.S. tax money and kills people all over the world every day. So, I'm not an advocate of more military spending. But at that time, there was a legitimate concern for the political class about how they were going to defend this project against the British Empire, the French Empire, the Spanish Empire. So Hamilton's argument is that, look, the only way that we are going to maintain sovereignty is if we have a state that's wealthy enough to fund internal administration and to fund a navy and to fund an army to defend itself. And the only way we're going to do that is if we transition our economy away from an exclusive dependence on agriculture towards a manufacturing-based economy that is still also agricultural, as the U.S. economy still is today, a very heavily agricultural economy, major agricultural producer and exporter, but also a major player not only in finance, but still, despite deindustrialization, a major industrial powerhouse. And he makes this case for economic transformation in terms of sovereignty and the need to defend this project. He offers an olive branch to Southern interests. First part of it's going on and on about how the South shouldn't fear industrialization. The South should not worry because, in fact, building an industrial base in the North will increase markets for Southern goods. And then finally, he goes on to enumerate what he calls the means proper. And the means proper are an economic policy toolbox that is deceptively simple. And each one of these in isolation doesn't seem that significant, but you put them all together and think about using them in concert under a plan, and you realize the importance and significance of naming all these things. So he lays out the need for tariffs of various types, subsidies for whole classes of goods, subsidies for specific firms. And he often uses different language for this. He doesn't, for example, use the word tariffs, and he doesn't use the word subsidies. He's talking about levies and bounties and all this other stuff. Calls for government-led quality control of products to increase essentially the national brand in manufacturing. The specific targeted tax breaks for strategic commodities. The government must have the power to ban the export of certain goods. It must have the power to ban the import of certain goods. And it must have the power to then also tweak and change those bans as the need for strategic raw materials should allow. And he again returns to finance, the importance of there being a national system of remittances. He calls for the federal government to take on the role of supporting research and development and education, for the federal government to build a transportation system. And last but not least, he calls for essentially a planning board. This is the last thing the report says. And it's not quite Goss plan a la the Soviet Union, but it's something like the MITI, the Japanese Ministry of International Trade and Industry, that is the rector of kind of Japanese industrialization, the overseeing body of the project that becomes the Japanese industrial success story. So this is all put before Congress. Parts of it are adopted, parts of it are rejected. Hamilton leaves the government when John Adams comes into office in 1795. And then the reputation of the Federalists takes a real hit under John Adams. Hamilton's personal politics are also moving in a pretty despotic, kind of nasty direction at this time as well, though he's out of political life. And the Federalists are swept out of office in what's called the Revolution of 1800. And Jefferson comes in with his crew. And Jefferson sets about dismantling all of the developmentalist infrastructure that was beginning to be set in motion. He crucially eliminates all internal taxes, and the federal government's tax take goes from 300 million down to 51 million, I think it was. Might have even been less than that. Well, you'll just have to buy the book, won't you, and find that number for yourself. So massive reduction in taxes. This is generally described as kind of a progressive cut in taxes, because the only thing, there was no income tax, it was only consumption that was taxed. And generally what's described as being having been taxed was newspapers, liquor, you know, things that working class people were interested in. But left out is also slaves were taxed, houses were taxed, carriages were taxed. So the elite paid lots of taxes, and they didn't like doing that. And particularly the Southern slaveocracy paid a lot of taxes, and they didn't want to pay these taxes. So Jefferson removes all that. He eliminates the whole, Hamilton has created a kind of internal revenue service with 11 Coast Guard cutters to police trade, cuts the military, which I would love to see done today, cuts the Navy, I would love to see that done today, but it was something different in 1800. And lo and behold, long story short, what happens is the British start pressing up on this new Republican experiment, boarding American ships, kidnapping American sailors, claiming that anyone, the British claim that anyone who was born in Britain was a British subject, right? You were not a British citizen, but you were essentially property of the royal government. You did not have the right to renounce your citizenship. You were a subject. So they're seizing American sailors and hampering American shipping. And American shipping was an enormous part of the economy, and it was an enormous component of manufacturing. Shipbuilding was a huge industry in the new economy, as it had been in the colonial period, largely because of the tremendous wood resources that the country had. And they could build good ships for very cheap compared to in Europe. All of this leads to a disastrous embargo against Britain. And then after two terms, Jefferson is out, Madison comes in, the same problem is continuing. The British are now landing and demanding supplies for their ship, and there's a riot in Virginia for their ships, and there's a riot in Virginia, so some violence, and Madison declares war on the UK, on Britain, and that is the beginning of the War of 1812. And the War of 1812, I call the apocalypse of small government. This is what small government delivers in its first iteration in the US. There's all sorts of horrendous violence attendant to that war, American militias raiding into Canada and killing civilians and burning towns. And the British burn DC. They invade, they burn the White House, they burn Congress, and they have this new political project by the throat. But due to their exhaustion, fighting the French continuously, really since the 1750s on, they don't have it in them, and they also don't see the utility of recolonizing America. So it's by sheer luck, essentially, that the U.S. is not broken up and recolonized under as a result of the War of 1812. What then happens is that, I should say, that Jefferson has also allowed the Bank of the United States, which was 20% public owned and central to Hamilton's vision for an economic transformation. He's let that 20-year charter expire. And after the War of 1812, Jeffersonians, these small government types, are forced, due to the crisis that their policies have created, to tack back and move towards a kind of Hamiltonian agenda. And this is a pattern that you will see again and again in American history, and really in the history of capitalism. I open the book with a short discussion of Karl Polanyi because he's useful in illuminating this. And it is, the pattern is that with the beginning of capitalism, a class emerges of capitalists, of elites, who do not want to be subjected to regulation and do not want to pay taxes, and they organize themselves and they push back and against any kind of regulation and taxation. They inevitably win, and then their victories create crises that force sometimes the very same politicians to violate their own ideology and reimpose planning, reimpose taxation to socialize losses and have the state step in and once again guide the economy deliberately rather than letting the invisible hand have its way. And we see that pattern in the wake of the War of 1812. There's this opposition to the idea of planning, to the idea of state ownership, to the idea of regulation. That opposition is victorious. That victory produces a crisis. That crisis requires a policy level 180 and a return to planning. And the great contradiction in American economic history is that our discourse and our rhetoric doesn't reflect this. The Jeffersonian ideology of small government remains hegemonic to this day. And even when you have very interventionist, Dyer-Giest policies during the New Deal, for example, right? You have Franklin Roosevelt in his 1932 Commonwealth Address talking about achieving Jeffersonian ends with Hamiltonian means. So that's the contradiction that plagues us to this day. And we continue on this pattern of the forces of laissez-faire gaining policy victories, creating crises, and then being forced to violate their own ideology. We saw that in 2008 when all these free marketeers get their way. That creates a financial bubble and a crash. And that requires, regardless of ideology, the massive socialization of all these losses and the de facto partial nationalization of the U.S. and, in fact, international banking system. The report, and then I'll wrap up my comments, the report is influential at the level of states, which go on to build canals following the example of the Erie Canal and pursuing protection and support for manufacturers. And it's also taken up by Europeans. Frederick List comes to America and is very influenced by this. In the 1820s, Henry Clay of Kentucky becomes the champion of these Hamiltonian ideas. They're known as the American system at first, and then the American school, then the American system. And this is taken up by Frederick List. He goes back to Germany, where it becomes known as the national system. List's ideas brought from America are very influential in the creation of the German Historical School of Economics. The German experiments with state-led industrialization, very defensively about dealing with the power of Britain. Those German experiments and plans are then taken up very explicitly by the Japanese after the Meiji Restoration. In the 1850s, when European and American gunboats start threatening Japan, their markets are forced open. There's a revolution of urban, young, middle-class modernizers who bring in European experts, accountants, engineers, military officers, and do this forced sort of march towards industrialization. These same ideas are used to greater and lesser extent throughout the world for decades, and they're absolutely fundamental in the experience of South Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore, and now China, and even places like Vietnam. So now I'm not holding out developmentalist capitalism as like, this is the desideratum that the US left should be going for. This is where we need to go. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is something simpler, which is that planning, government intervention in the economy, and economic planning, and a limited, even distorted form of socialism of some sort, or something socialistic, is not foreign, right? But it's actually part and parcel of American history. It is organic to the history of American capitalism. And so looking at our current immediate crisis, not the long-term crisis of what kind of society do we want to live in ultimately, but looking at the immediate crisis of how do we get off of fossil fuels? What are we going to do about the fact that our economy is totally unsustainable? Well, we could do a lot worse than look back at the real political origins of the American Industrial Revolution to realize that, oh, government planning and the idea of an explicit economic transition were crucial to developing this economy. And if you look around the world at the economic history of any number of states, where you find successful capitalist development, you find developmentalist states at the heart of it. And where you find economies that remain on the periphery and remain despite their political status as the de facto economic colonies of some greater powers, in those situations, you find a political class that follows the dictates of laissez-faire. And so, getting off fossil fuels involves essentially a reindustrialization. It involves euthanizing the fossil fuel industry, but also then building out a clean energy sector and a clean technology sector in the form of vehicles and retrofitted buildings. It's a huge industrial project, a project of reindustrialization. How are we going to do that? We could do much worse than looking at how we did it the first time. And trying to make these ideas that many Americans probably see as suspiciously foreign and alien, trying to get people to realize that actually there is American economic planning is as American as apple pie and violence, to quote H. Rapp Brown, right, who said that violence was as American as apple pie, but so is economic planning. Economic planning and public ownership and the imposition of the public will and the idea of the general welfare being imposed upon the economic order is as American as apple pie.
So let's get to some questions. It was a great presentation. I'll just jump right into some questions since we don't have that much time. Michael on Facebook asks, are there more or less sectors of capitalists that benefit from laissez-faire or strong centralized states? And it's a matter of which triumphs, like within competing capitalist interests, or does the class as a whole move back and forth between more and less government? It seems to me that at certain points in American history, it's been these policies, let's say in the 1930s, the New Deal era policies, were pushed primarily by a popular coalition, but there were certain segments of capital that were better able to cope with the demands, then became part of the New Deal coalition. Like, for example, big oil. Let's say big oil, right? It's capital intensive. Whereas Southern agricultural interests in the 30s were labor intensive. So one was better able to cope with regulatory and wage demands than the other, right? And therefore was more willing to join in the statist coalition. And I guess that's kind of what the question is getting to, like differentiating between different blocks of capital and how useful an exercise that is.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose there are differences in, you know, capital factions, but I think it's also just, it has to do with the size of the strength of the capitalist class, right? They become deluded once they are strong and feel that they don't need these protections. Then they start resisting them until they enter into a crisis, and then they are in favor of it, especially if there's some assistance to that industry. But I don't think that there's, I wouldn't draw too distinct a line between these factions of capital, that they generally also, you know, they're all in favor of laissez-faire when things are booming and going well. And then when the crisis comes, they tend to shift back towards towing the line that goes along with the socialization of their disasters. I mean, certainly the South's concern with labor costs is important. I mean, I have a more of an ideological reading on that, that it is rooted in the tradition of maximalist control in the South, and that it's actually kind of economically irrational for the Southern political class, which to this day, you know, advocates openly for low wages as an economic benefit, as their comparative advantage.
So I guess traditionally in developmental states, let's say in Korea and elsewhere, the successes and the failures are often distinguished by the willingness of elites to accept state discipline. So for example, the Korean experiment and other East Asian developmental states worked so well because the state was able to not just subsidize capitalists to do certain things, but also discipline them to do other things. So I guess an example today would be subsidies to green capitalists are a necessary evil today to change the pricing and speed of development of certain renewable technologies. But at the same time, we need to be able to punish companies doubling Absolutely, down on yeah. investments in coal, for instance. And it seems like the US capitalists are always willing to accept the subsidies, but we don't really have the power or the whip, if that makes sense.
And well, I guess how do we overcome that and thinks about economic policy as much as it thinks about other questions, right? I mean, the cultural turn has, I think, been tremendously damaging for the US left. So we need to be thinking much more about you know, dealing with real economic problems at what scale, by what means. I mean, if we did have power of a state or a town or federal government, what would we do, right? I don't see lots of discussion of that on the left. But absolutely, the stick is as important as the carrot. And I mean, one of my favorite facts from the South Korean example is that capital flight from South Korea of over $1 million, this law goes back to, I think it was in the 70s, it might have been as early as the 60s, but you know, that capital flight of $1 million or more was punishable with the death penalty. And that was maximum, and minimum was 10 years. And no capitalist was actually ever put to death under this law, but capitalists were prosecuted and did years and years in prison for trying to get their money out of the country, you know, wanting to have Swiss bank accounts and you know, villas in faraway places. So absolutely, yeah, developmentalism really only works if there's that stick. And that only happens when there are social movements that, you know, stiffen the spine of the state by threatening its existence, right? I mean, the South Korea, the developmentalist project in South Korea actually it begins as a kind of right-wing project, but it's the tremendous class struggle of the Korean workers and the Korean students that gives it its progressive characteristics and also stiffens the spine of these developmentalist politicians and bureaucrats to play tough with the capitalist class, because they realize there has to be results, right? We have to increase incomes. We have to increase growth. This project has to work, not just for the capitalists, but also for the working class, because they're continually out in the street, you know, fighting and in many cases dying in these fights with the cop and threatening the stability of the whole system.
So I guess the approach of the contemporary left, a lot of it is we will just build power extra parliamentarily with uncompromising demands and popular struggles, let's say for demands for Green New Deal and things like that. But it won't be us administrating the state or that transitional period. It'll be a figure like Joe Biden. So in which case, best to have your demands as undiluted as possible, as radical as possible, then you're not really thinking about statecraft or constructing this kind of transitional demands versus the part of the left that that I guess through the Corbyn and Sanders experiment started thinking about what it would mean to govern and administer state in the interest of some sort of social democratic development program that can deal with some acute problems, can deal with climate change, but that we won't be able to wield in the direction of socialism in a really radical way. That's not really a question, but does that make sense? Like that, like the contrast between the traditional orientation of the left towards just being an extra parliamentary force and a orientation towards some Bernie-crats and others towards thinking about what it would take to immediately wield state power in imperfect conditions.
Well, I think you're framing the question as two different political strategies, and I don't think that's actually the issue. I mean, you can have extra parliamentary and an electoral strategy, but the question is rather, what are we demanding, right? You know, currently on the climate front, we're demanding divestment. I have written against divestment and then, to be polite, stopped doing it. But I think divestment is a stupid idea. And it's been a campaign that the climate left has been using for now 10 years, and it's achieved almost nothing. It's achieved nothing, really. And, you know, well, what's the problem with that? What's going on there? What's going on? We just have these symbolic demands. We're not being critical thinkers about, you know, what can we do given our position? So what we're not demanding are the things that I think we should be demanding, which is that we should be demanding that universities and town governments and state governments immediately clean up their own consumption, right? Universities all have tiny little vehicle fleets. They could all be electric, right? State governments, similarly. Okay, you can't do the state police. They've got range anxiety. But I mean, you know, the maintenance crews, all these fleets should be electrified, right? Activists should be demanding this kind of stuff. In lots of the country, there are deregulated or semi-deregulated electrical markets where you can purchase for a small premium power source from wind and solar. We should be demanding that state governments and the federal government and town governments and universities with all their electric consumption be sourcing from clean energy, not put solar panels on the roof, which is the most expensive and least effective way of producing solar energy, but no, buying solar sourced power through utilities that have utility scale solar farms and are looking for customers or trying to compete in these markets, right? I mean, these are the kinds of demands that should be made. So it's not, I don't see it as like, oh, you know, should you pursue an election strategy or an extra parliamentary? I'm in favor of both of those, but it's like, you should be demanding concrete and sophisticated economic reforms, not posturing.
But I guess the key thing that comes along with that is that when we say as socialists, like our movements on the left, eco-socialists and others have historically said, climate change can only be solved by socialism. We need eco-socialism. It's eco-socialism or barbarism or whatnot. What we're missing is, even though obviously I think you would agree with this, the longer term environmental crisis of the next couple hundred years would be much better off. We might only be able to solve that with some sort of socialist system, but the short-term problem of climate change, we're gonna have to figure out a way to solve using the existing bourgeois state, using existing kind of frameworks for doing so. And that kind of brings us back
Or maybe it's not even solve it, but like take meaningful steps in real time under these conditions. Certainly, capitalism is not sustainable. You cannot have an economic system on a finite planet that's dependent on constant growth and in which there's, you know, externalities of the most horrendous sort produced all the time and not factored in. And all this kind of free market stuff, like, oh, pricing and the externalities. No. What you do with the externalities, i.e. pollution, is you make them illegal, you know? That's like the same way you deal with rape and murder. You don't say, okay, well, we've got this problem of rape and murder, so we're going to issue permits for rape and murder. No, it's illegal, you know, and you use state power to try and prevent it. Similarly with dumping sludge in the water, et cetera, and pollution in the air. So in the long run, absolutely, you know, this is not a sustainable economic system. But if you're serious about the implications of climate change, climate science, and you're serious about politics, then it becomes clear that crucial first steps should involve like making demands that there is immediate and meaningful steps taken towards decarbonization. And in the process, there's all sorts of openings about like then, okay, living wages, rights of unions, you know, like, well, what about the state owning, having and maintaining some of the intellectual property that it helps produce in funding all of this new clean technology. Those are the arguments that Mariana Mazzucato is pushing over in the UK, right? There's all these openings that become available.
Hamilton, basically, you're seeing a figure that advocated for an early form of planning and state intervention. And a lot of our complaints about Hamilton relate
to
his...
Planning and state intervention in the interest of total economic transformation, right? It was like, right, we're here and we need to get there, and we're not going to get to this desired state of being without a plan, you know, conceiving of what the means are and then pursuing those means to get there. So that's the key thing. It's like planning for a transition.
And much of our critique of Hamilton relates to who he thought should be making these decisions for the state. In other words, the fact that he had a relatively or a quite exclusionary view of who was fit to wield political power. But we can combine some of this inspiration, some of this vision as far as economic development and planning with today's left's view about the fact that we want a society in which every cook can make some sort of you know, democratic input or whatnot, but that ultimately you're saying that planning and that democracy isn't really incompatible.
Right. And the one thing, I mean, I would not defend Hamilton as a Democrat. He's not, you know, he does have autocratic tendencies. But the one thing I would say in defense of him is that there is this misreading of the struggle around the Constitution, in my opinion, which has the state governments as democratic and the new central government as aristocratical and oppressive. But if you actually look at the constitutions of these state governments, many of them are much more reactionary than the federal constitution. Many of them had, they explicitly didn't allow women to vote. They had racial exclusions. And many of these state governments were basically just the vehicles of local gangs of plutocrats. Okay, they're smaller and they're like potentially more accountable to the populace, but they weren't in practice in many cases. They were even more locked down by financiers, slave owners, merchants, elite shippers, big landlords than the federal government. So there, some of what appears as Hamilton's anti-democratic politics is also his dislike of state government. And he actually wanted to abolish state governments. He just thought that state governments were the repositories of basically second-rate self-dealing men, and that they were going to get in the way, and you couldn't have two sovereignties existing in the same limits. This would lead to war, which eventually it does.
We certainly would have been better off with a unitary government. I think that's without a doubt from even the most mild redistributive goals would be better off, better served.
Well, you wouldn't have Donald Trump as president, because the Electoral College is based on the Constitution's concessions to the states, that states get to control the time and the place and the form of their elections, right? That out of that comes the state control of elections, comes the Electoral College and, you know, minority rule. We're now in, you know, a long run of minority rule, as it were.
Well, Christian, thank you so much for your time. For everyone else, please tune in Friday again at 6, and thank also you. Saturday at 1, and check out Christian's book, which is out now from Verso, Radical Hamilton. Thanks once again. Thanks to everyone for tuning in. Press like, press subscribe, check out Radical Hamilton.
Thanks a lot. Take care. Bye. We'll be right back.